We are moving on to the third panel, Interconnection Networks, Bridges of Cooperation and Development, is the title of this panel, during which distinguished speakers will try, through presentations and debates, to capture the new geopolitical, economic and social map of Northern Greece and the Balkans, the modernization of the existing ones, as well as the planning of new transport and energy networks. I will give the floor now to Mr. Konstantinos Zervas, Mayor of Thessaloniki. Thank you very much.
Χρησιμοποιούμε και το ένα και το άλλο.
Dear Minister, dear guests, dear friends, good afternoon, everybody. I'm really happy to be here among all of you, and I'm really happy to see that such an important conference is taking place in our city, the city of Thessaloniki, which is a place of geographical and historical privilege. It has always been at the crossroads of cultures and states, a crossroads of Southeastern Europe and the Balkans. The truth is that those of us that live in this peninsula of the Balkans, but also our neighboring countries, are here to realize that we need to do much more and very quickly if we really want to bridge the gap between Western Europe and Eastern Europe. And we are finding ourselves at the whirlpool of big crises, climate change, the impact of urbanization. All of this is posing big challenges to all of us, especially when we need to deal with cases such as the pandemic that has stricken our country and our continent. At the same time, it's true that we can also say that we are in an era of opportunity during which our world is interconnected more than ever. Traveling is easier. People are more aware about civil rights, about environmental issues, and many more. And at the same time, there is this elaboration of international relations among the countries of the areas with the enlargement of Schengen area with Romania and Bulgaria, and gradually with the rest of the countries. I firmly believe that the mobility of our citizens and the collaboration of our cities can bring great benefit to all of us. And of course, I'm not only speaking about local economies, but also the exchange of views, good practices, habits, which during this interchange can positively contribute to the future of all of us. So I'm talking about the need to invest in culture even more, to the extrovert character of our societies, in order to be able to work together towards the goal of building a universal framework of respect towards values and principles, and to get rid of any form of discrimination. So imagine that within the framework of Discover EU, an initiative of the EU which will help young people to discover European countries, and apart from that, giving the opportunity to people to travel around and break down stereotypes and prejudices against other people. This also, part of this was also another initiative, B40, where at least 40 big municipalities of the Balkans met about one year ago in Istanbul to exchange views and opinions on that. Besides, dear friends, we've been residents of this area for centuries now. We've met rivalries and disputes, and there is some heavy heavy heritage and history. Churchill has had said that the Balkan states are producing more history than what they can consume, but we are the heirs of this heritage. We share so much culture, tradition, gastronomy, habits, everyday way of living, which in many cases means that it might be even hard to distinguish where it all started from. I want to believe that we have left national aside, and we have focused on our common future and common interests. The Balkans and Southeastern Europe need to take this seriously. And, however, the war that broke out more than 1 year ago is still a shocking event to all of us, reminding us of how important it is to remember that nothing is taken for granted. Challenges, as I said, are common for all of us, for all societies. I, as a member of the local administration, can tell you for sure that we are in many cases the ones that need to find resolution. However, developments and the creation of job vacancies are part of the key to these problems, and these are common. So I'm talking about challenges such as urbanization, aging population. The transmission of diseases, such as the case of the pandemic, technological modifications, sustainable developments. What is created today needs to be attractive in the future as well. Also, the creation of new economic trends. And, of course, equally important, I consider that it is to think about climate change. These are all issues that require a lot of time to analyze, but let's not forget that they are of primary importance to all citizens. So in this environment, any single thing that can be added to or multiply our strengths and power and secure some resources will be the most important part of our development on the 21st century. And I hope that this conference will contribute to that and look into the ways in which societies can move forward. But what is networking today? It's solidarity. It's help. Help in civil protection issues, for instance, such as the case of the huge earthquake that afflicted our neighboring country of Turkey and Syria. We need to support this network of mutual help and support. Fires, wildfires, and so many more things. The exchange of good practices also, the exchange of experience, knowledge, especially among people that have so many things in common, starting from Turkey, Albania, Bulgaria. Solutions that have been effective in these countries might be effective to us as well. Also, information. The more we know about each other, the more we know about these problems and these challenges that we are faced with, the better we can get close to each other. Also, tourism. Our Deputy Minister will talk about that. This is also another channel of communication and activity that can bring people together, and we have got so much perspective in the development of this film. We've already had our success stories, but there is still a lot to be done. Also infrastructure, I am engineer myself, I am kind of obsessed with infrastructure, so if we manage to create all those of vital importance infrastructure that will be able to connect our countries and our economies to those of Central Europe and the rest of the world, then we will be able to have set, to have laid the proper foundation for our development. Highways, railways, ports, airports, even bike roads, I would say, all of these are essential to the development of our economies. Energy as well. Energy is something that we have been talking a lot about lately, and all of us have seen the impact of the energy crisis during this year, and which was turns even bigger after the war in Ukraine. And if we manage to deal with this, we will be able to flourish even more. Finally, networking is also economy itself. And I think that this is the biggest part. Being an extroverted economy, offering mobility, supporting innovation, new technology, commerce, all of these factors are the strongest form of networking, because we've seen in history that wherever roads were built and wherever it was possible for merchants to bring their products from one place to another, there was also economic development. So now let's focus on the enhancement and the empowerment of our economies on the basis of mutual benefits and the construction of common interests for all of us.
And this is
also part of the initiative of B40. Any type of such networking is beneficial towards this goal. Finally, let me tell you a few things about our town.
When
someone speaks of Southeastern Europe and the Balkans and the challenges faced with by the states of that part of Europe, Thessaloniki has always taken great interest in that. Our geographical, our cultural, our financial and geopolitical point of reference turns its into an important crossroads, a meeting point, and years now, I can tell you that the most important thing for our town is for it to remain the gates of the Balkans. So our ambition is to be an important meeting point of this area, a big port, tourist destination, educational center. We do have very good educational institutions of all levels and economic development prospects. Thessaloniki is growing, it's getting stronger and is investing in public spaces, changing its face with the aim to be elevated even more. If you knew what our town was like in the past, maybe you've already noticed that there has already been some change, and in the near future things will have changed even more. This city will become a vibrant place again. We won't say goodbye to our kids anymore, leaving our town seeking a better future. Now they will be able to find a good job here in this area. So this is what our town wants to be, a success story, to be a Balkan city, a Mediterranean city, and a European city at the same time, which is managing to set the example for everybody. I really want to wish you the best of luck with your works in this conference. I wish you to have productivity and some fruitful conversation, and also have the opportunity to enjoy your stay here in our town.
Thank you very much, Mr. Mayor, for this inspiring talk on Thessaloniki and its potential in the region. So let me now, first of all, thank you all for being here. It's a pleasure to have you, although it's almost time for lunch. We had our lunch, of course, but things are getting a little bit warm up here. So let me start by introducing our panelists. From my right, I have Deputy Minister of Tourism, Mrs. Sophia Zaharaki. I will move on to Mrs. Theodora Georgieva, Executive Manager, Executive Officer and Member of the Board of IGB. I'll go to Mrs. Hazal Duran, International Relations Manager of Anadolu Agency in Türkiye. And we have, of course, with us Mrs. Marina Spiridaki, Manager of Corporate Affairs of Aegean Airlines. So let me start discussing on networks of interconnection, bridges, and of cooperation and development with Mrs. Zaharaki, and being inspired with, of what Mr. Mayor said, that Thessaloniki could be a success story, has all its potential, and can pave the way for the whole region. What about tourism? Is Thessaloniki could become a tourism hub in the region? And the whole, what have we done so far?
First of all, Sophia, thank you very much for the invitation, and a warm thank you to the agencies being present here. Of course, the Athenian-Macedonian News Agency that has inspired us to be here. It was a difficult task for me to be physically here from Athens, but it was a pleasure to attend such an interesting meeting that is also here reinforced by not a men's panel. Let me add that for the first time probably I'm among dear friends, women, the majority of which are here at the panel. Thank you, Mayor, for assisting. Not just a manel, but maybe a womanel for starters. Anyway, thank you very much again for the invitation. It's really an inspiring talk, and it's not just words, because you just heard the mayor compiling a speech that has facts, and it does have facts about those bridges and those networks that we need to develop even further. I'm the Deputy Minister for Tourism. I call it hospitality better than tourism, because we mostly refer to this feeling of welcoming people to our country, as you do in your lovely countries. Theodora, we've had with your country an amazing relationship also in tourism sector under the auspices of their World Tourism Organization, which is also a network where we find colleagues and friends from many of Southeastern countries. And of course, Natalia, I want to wish the best for your country after these tormented times that you experienced after the earthquake. It was a bridge and it was a network after a strenuous relationship that we have had in the past years, mostly on the verbal, let's say, notes. But now we extended this helping hand, and we were very pleased and very honored to be in Turkey assisting with the civil protection units and assisting the people of Turkey on a daily note, of course, with the whole of Greece being united in supporting during these difficult times. And again, I would also like to thank Marina. Marina coming from Aegean, because this synergy that we are promoting in order to help restoring and recovering tourism, it has become a reality also with Aegean, which is a pillar, a very basic pillar for this recovery. Mayor talked about Thessaloniki, but we know that during these times of your term, Thessaloniki has really been assisted and aided to becoming a hub also for hospitality. Let me explain how. Because, again, a city of extroversion that has a little bit curbed the extroversion part because of pandemic, a crisis that we have suffered all, is seeing now some days which are quite satisfactory, to mention the incoming numbers, the average spending, the average stay of people coming to Thessaloniki and the metropolitan part of Thessaloniki. And of course, the investment part, dear Mayor, that we see from people investing here in Thessaloniki, and when we talk about hotels, when we're talking about tourist agencies and new markets. We are also seeing a lot of efforts that have been made towards gastronomy. Let me add something that we worked together with the mayor. It was a successful fit. Thessaloniki is now one, the first ever Greek city to be one of the creative city of gastronomy of UNESCO. And of course, you understand that this is a certificate of excellence that Thessaloniki will be carrying for the years to come. You know that this is also an amazing trip of recipes and local products that has this Southeastern Balkan, let's say, slash Balkan element, because all these recipes, they come from all different places. Sometimes you don't even know the root of where it has come from, but it is also a very tangible fact of this journey and of these bridges. Let me also mention that apart from the Thessaloniki, let's say, part of the reply, that we have seen that these bridges and channels have worked excellently in the part of tourism, also, as I said before, under the auspices of the World Tourism Organization, because we are working very closely with the member states in order to find the recovery mode to restarting tourism, getting back and applying the digital COVID certificate in order to be able to start traveling again, and also trying to record the tendencies of the new traveler. The mayor mentioned it before. We want to record the tendencies, and it's a common challenge for all, from all. So we should move Sofia from crisis to challenges that are common. If we want to attract more people coming to our neighborhood, and this is beyond borders, we need to see, of course, that the younger population is thriving, is looking for sustainable destinations. Sustainable meaning not just the way that we build our buildings, we improve the infrastructure, but also how we engage the local community into this whole achievement, into, you know, restoring our cities again. And of course, also talking about cooperation that has to do with slow tourism, ecotourism, and of course the southeastern region offers a lot of that. The protected areas, when we're talking about Natura and Ramsar areas that are very much, you know, present in our territories, and of course working closely on the cultural tourism part, which is carries a lot of common elements. So I would say that potential is there, but recording the new trends and tendencies, that is a must for is a must element for all countries, collecting data and applying this into strategy. Please take into consideration that in our strategy with the Ministry of Culture, we have three basic pillars: quality, diversification, and definitely sustainability. So we are working on that, and we are of course more than willing to share experiences, what we have achieved, and what we strive to improve here in our country. Last but not least, not having to do with tourism, let me add to the very important contribution that the news agencies have to play, the national news agencies have to play when recording facts and data, sharing this in a very democratic and transparent way, which I believe that is also the very key fact of our meeting today.
Yes, that's for sure, and thank you very much for your intervention, Mrs. Minister. You touched upon the big challenge of the pandemic has brought to our lives, but another challenge was the war and the problems in energy that has caused a turbulence in the region. Hopefully, these all problems will be, you know, tackled by a great project, the IGB project, that has immensely changed Europe's energy map. So, Mrs. Georgieva, I want to turn to you. I have heard you saying that this goes into two aspects. One aspect is the national aspect for the two host countries, for Greece and Bulgaria. The other one is the international one, and how this can help our neighbors here in the South Eastern Europe. So, could you please elaborate a bit on that and give us some insight on the IGB project? Can we have the presentation of Mrs. Georgieva, please?
So, thank you very much. I'm very much honored that I have been invited here, and we have, and especially in this such honorable, let's say, forum here. So I really appreciate also your media and media generally, because our long-term partnership shows that it really matters, and it's representing all our news, and we are really a transparent company and try to update you on a daily basis, and you are always fair. Both you internationally and also in Bulgaria, we also rely a lot. Let me brief you shortly about IGB. So this is a project of high security. So it's really related with energy security. By the way, talking purely about Bulgaria, it was the only way we to have different diversification of sources and energy security, and it becomes even much more valid when Ukraine war has happened. And it is also, let's say, although the scale of IGB is not so big, we are talking about infrastructure that is connected with Southern Gas Corridor. This is the only one connected in, let's say, being able to haul gas from Bulgaria and north. And what, where are we now? So the potentials are, here, as you see, we are talking about flows, which is from Caspian Sea, Azeri, Azeri gas mainly. And also we are interconnected with DESFA, where we expect lots of synergy with LNG terminals in DESFA, also in Turkey. So the biggest synergy definitely is with the newest terminal, Alexandropolis, where also logistically it stands very close. And we are waiting really this project to happen soon, because this is going to ensure really the expansion of the project. Although the project has just started a couple of months ago, we, let's say, taken into consideration the new environment, it has almost been booked, so we are really, it's showing that it's a real game changer, mm-hmm. And there is a need to think even now strategically, although we with my colleague here, we are also, let's say, trying to make and to ensure smooth operation, but now we have been faced strategically to think about expansion. So that's, okay, so we are talking about sources which are not only limited from Azeri, but everywhere, USA, Qatar, Egypt, Israel, so really potentials are a lot. And talking about different corridors through IGB, we can go through Ukraine, Moldova, where right now we are helping a lot to Moldovan market because, let's say, huge booking now is passing through IGB, so through Trans-Balkan corridor. Also, there is a synergy, a vertical corridor from Greece, Bulgaria, Hungary, Romania, Hungary, which is we recently signed a memorandum of understanding because without it was the pillar was missing was IGB. And also, why not to go into with the interconnector of Serbia? There is also another route that should be exhausted, and we hope that this year it will be ready and then a flow through Serbia. Hungary, why not reaching to Baumgarten is also possible. So different routes and really showing the diversification of sources is especially in this timing, it is not only for ensuring heating competition of prices, but it has been shown that it's worth having this infrastructure. So it's shortly showing that this is mostly for the auditorium, it's a good public-private entity, which is, let's say, looks like a rather complex, but is showing that it's having two governments behind us, Bulgarian and Greek one. So that's helped a lot during the challenges on the way. So financial structure is also, you know, important because you are seeing that we are using taking lots of grants from European Union. We made the whole capex altogether is at the level of 250 million euro, and we do have debt 110 million euro from European Investment Bank, and all this with the help of our shareholders is showing that we are really trying to make the most competitive route for our consumers, industry and consumers. So that took a bit longer because in 2015 we have been, trying to finalize financing, and it was not an easy, especially not finding an additional grant at the level of 39 million euro, because we are talking about exempted project, and it is not so easy to go through the whole path from financing. But we did it in a good way, and we may say that even now we are within the capex, and we are happy to say that we are one of the most competitive structure also talking about costs. So this I think that I have mentioned shortly. So a month or two immediately after our COD, we become an ANSOC member, and we are, I could say that we are one of the most transparent infrastructure, because every booking here could be seen in Enzok, and you can see what has been booked from Komotini, entry in the platform Prisma, and also you can also see in Stara Zagora. So it's transparency is the one which we are driving as a company, and it's one of our main value. So here we can shortly say that we are what we are offering, but this you can see easily whenever you are going to ENSOC on a daily basis, and we are offering all the products like an ordinary TSO. 50% has been booked even before COD, and now we are talking. We are offering very actively also the other capacity, monthly, quarterly, following ENSOC calendar. And as I have mentioned, that we are happy that having really, let's say, a huge booking and being part of helping countries like Moldova and Ukraine in such a difficult time. So here mostly the most important is also to put emphasis that yes, by this interconnector, which is at the level of 3 BCM, let's say to 3 BCM is almost the whole consumption in Bulgaria, the market itself, and we are ensuring 1/3 and even right now even more of the consumption of Bulgaria, because I mean the consumption generally after war went down. Also, let's say we, as I mentioned, there is it is like a trustful route, not to different corridors to Central Europe and to Western Europe. And I think that IGB generally it's quite a good example, which is integrating all these countries. And by working together, we really could build up, let's say, supplying diversified sources also to Western Balkans, as I mentioned before. And we can, let's say, of course, we are also thinking about future and ensuring, let's say, transportation, making research for ensuring transportation via hydrogen, with, let's say, how to start up early without impacting on the investment. But that's also important to be mentioned. And I think that, yes, strategically, this is the bottom line here is that diversification of sources, energy security, it's not only a word, it has happened, and it has happened in as a landmark. This project is like a game changer, landmark, which is really boosting, let's say, especially in the war, it is helping to ensure heating for the basic needs, and it's also helping to for sustainability of countries which are suffering. So I'm really happy that together with my colleagues from ICGP, with my colleague George, we are really, let's say, working in a project which is like a cause for the region.
Thank you very much, Ms. Yeah. Georgieva. I'm very optimistic now that we will have enough energy to welcome a lot of tourists in our region, but do we have the capacity in terms of the airlines? Let's go to Mrs. Spiridaki from Aegean. And Mrs. Spiridaki, is Thessaloniki and the region high up in the agenda of your company? And what are your future plans, not only for the city, but for the region as a whole?
You bet it is. Thank you for the invitation and the opportunity to address such an audience. And of course, visiting again Thessaloniki in such a beautiful day, which is amazing. Thank you. Thank you very much. For those who don't know us and still haven't traveled with us, hopefully not too many, we are a nearly 25 years old airline operating also domestic and international network. We are actually the biggest airline, and after inheriting our Olympic airlines, we gladly consider ourselves as the flag carrier, proudly to welcome everyone in Greece. And as we say, it's nearly as you're in the Greek soil the moment you enter one of our aircraft. We operate, we have been repeatedly awarded for the quality of service and the safety of our operation and the innovation and the customer-centric culture we proudly consider ourselves to offer. We are operating with approximately 76 aircraft in 46 countries. This year we have the biggest network ever, 161 destinations, more than 265 direct connections from our eight hubs, one main hub in Athens and the second one in Thessaloniki. coming to Thessaloniki, which is of course at the heart of our operation, not o- and also at the heart of a general alliance in itself, not only because of course it serves the network purposes, but also because it has a symbolic meaning as well. From Thessaloniki, from this airport, Aegean actually started its international operations back in 2001. So it is considered as a place for innovation and new ventures for us. And ever since, we try to hold and continually grow our network. We continue to invest in Thessaloniki with increasing capacity. This year, we had the biggest winter network as well, nearly 22 connections, also domestic and international. We invested heavily on that, nearly 15% more capacity than the previous year, and nearly equal to what it was in 2019, precisely because we wanted to provide the opportunity for everyone who wants to visit Thessaloniki for a city break, for a short city break, or do business in Thessaloniki, invest in Thessaloniki, study, leave, to offer them this opportunity. And of course, making it easy for them to travel any time of the day, this is a part of our mission. Therefore, we actually envisage Thessaloniki to thrive. We grow with Thessaloniki, and we will continue to grow alongside. And we're very, very, very happy to see that there are initiatives taken that enhance the product, the offering, but also the quality of life, which is important, because what we say, and we sincerely believe it, is that if one of the permanent residents is happy to live and work and study in Thessaloniki, then it's the best advertisement for every traveler to come and have the same experience. So yes, we do invest and we will continue to invest. We are doing it actually for the nearly 25 years now, 20 years now. We plan to have also this summer an extensive network. We actually doubled the destinations, but I think we will have the opportunity of saying a few more. What we do, what we want to emphasize is that the actual results come out when we join forces. We join forces with the municipality, we join forces with the prefecture, we try to create common messages, and we try to support whatever it matters, and it's worth supporting in the city. Not only for those staying here, but also for those who want to come. Mm-hmm. That's why we see, I mean, who wouldn't see in a positive eye all these investments are taking place, but they will open up Thessaloniki to also economic opportunities. It is significant, of course, in a sustainable way, not only in the touristic side, but also in the actual the way you protect the environment. Well, we're really proud, and allow me just this to say that we have initiated the first sustainable aviation fuel program from Thessaloniki, nearly 1.5 year now. All the flights departing from Thessaloniki have a blend of sustainable aviation fuel, especially in times of crisis of energy. This was a huge investment for us. We hope to be able to continue. We will continue it from Thessaloniki, but providing the opportunity to do that also in other airports as well.
Thank you very much, Ms. Piridaki, for the insight. And I don't think there is anyone actually that hasn't traveled with Aegean.
I hope
yeah,
so.
Yeah, especially in the region. So let me now turn the floor to Mrs. Duran. Mrs. Duran, thank you very much for being here. You know, it was brief, hopefully, because of the earthquake in Türkiye and the devastating effects of it. So I'll give you the floor now to present to us how Anadolu agency has covered this disastrous earthquake, and then we will talk about bridges of solidarity, because we are talking about connectivity and air travels, we are talking about energy, but there are other kind of bridges that connect people. So could you please have the presentation of Mrs. Duran?
Thank you, Sophia, and firstly I would like to thank for all organizers to inviting and having us here in such a beautiful city. I think that it is a better way to discuss the bridges of cooperation and coordination between news agencies based on the recent earthquake in Turkey, because as you said before, we experienced one of the biggest disasters in the century, and how we manage to it, how we cover it, and how the solidarity between news agencies played a key role is important to underline. So, as you know, on the night of 6 February, Turkey had shaken one of the biggest catastrophes of this century. So, the earthquake resulted in a huge damage in 11 provinces of our country. Mm-hmm. So, as Charles Dickens said once, it was the worst of times for all of us. Because we have worried for the lives of our families and also our colleagues working and living in the region. So after just a couple of minutes after the earthquake, we just tried to reach our colleagues living in the region, but it was very difficult to reach them because all the communication lines were destroyed and disrupted. So our reporters based in Ankara and other provinces, they just moved to the earthquake region, but it was very difficult to reach them because all the roads, as you see in the picture, were destroyed. So we have waited on the roads to just reach to the region for hours. So you may all know that journalism is a difficult job, so it is very difficult to focus on our jobs even if our loved ones are in pain. So our reporters also did this during this earthquake. So while their families were also in pain, they tried to let people know about the disaster. So these photos are taken just a couple of minutes after the earthquake by our reporters living in the region, just minutes after. So during the earthquake, we divided our internal coordination into two levels. At the first level, our teams tried to get in touch with our colleagues living in the region and try to be sure that whether they are in safe or not. So we formed a rescue team to provide their urgent needs, including accommodation, physical aid, and transportation. So it took a couple of days to make sure about whether they are safe or not. And we see that almost all of them were affected, by whether they are or their families were affected by the disaster. So with a great sorrow, we learned the death of our reporter in Hatay, Burak Milli. He was a photographer and he lost his life during the earthquake with his wife and his 5-month-old daughter. And as Anadolu, we will try to open new projects to honor his name in the future. And our offices in Hatay and also in other parts of the region were also damaged. You can see the photo of our office before and after the earthquake. So our second team consisted of reporters have focused on the earthquake, and we dedicated our top reporters on this matter and sent them to the earthquake zone. And almost 400 reporters are working in the region and they are working in shifts. So, and it seems that they will be in the region for a long time. So some of you may know that we are providing a war journalism training since 2013. And actually we trained almost 500 journalists on working in emergency situations since 2013. So we really see the positive outcomes of this training after the earthquake, because in this training we cover many topics from journalism to personal safety, from first aid to communication in emergency situation. So we really saw the positive outcomes of this training on our reporters' skills.
So at the earthquake zone, we also used recent technology, and we also used drones a lot to take most comprehensive images. And our drones were showing the catastrophe and destruction after the earthquake, and they were used also by the world media a lot, these drone shootings. So we produced more than 70,000 visual content in the earthquake zone, and they're also used a lot by the world media, especially our photos and videos. And as our previous speakers also talk about this issue, but combating against misinformation and disinformation in the social media was also very critical for us during the earthquake, especially after the post-earthquake period. So Anadolu established a fact-checking line a couple of months before ago, and our fact-check line also took part in confirming the contents on digital media, whether they are true or not, to provide true information to the public. So even in this catastrophe, we see the power of solidarity, so how it matters for all of us, because people all over the world start to collect aid from the victims of the earthquake, and rescue teams from all over the countries, all over the world, just came to Türkiye to help us to save lives. So we really want to thank all of you, all the countries who sent their helps. And also we saw the same solidarity from news agencies, because we took very comforting messages from news agencies, and including ABNA-SE. So we are very grateful for the role that news agencies played in raising awareness about the situation and sharing our pain. Thank you all.
Thank you very much, Mrs. Duran. Thank you. Reconstructing this area will, of course, take a lot of time, but nothing compares to the loss of lives. So let's go back to Mrs. Georgieva now. Mrs. Georgieva, because we want some good news of the region. The region can produce good news. So we were talking about the IGP and the LNG in Alexandroupolis. You said that this could be a game changer. What are your synergies in the region with the LNG terminals? And what do you expect, I'll put a second part of the question, of the market test that you are having in the second part of 2023? We can sum up.
So, thank you for the questions. So I expect lots of synergy, especially within Greece and LNG terminals, the one which is existing in Revituze, and especially the one in Alexandroupolis. What I missed to mention is, there is a plan, at least what we know is that next year it is going to be ready. On the top of this, DESFA started to build a compressor station in Komotini, which is also very important, and we hope that by beginning of 2025 we are going to have a ready compressor station scaled at the level of 5 BCM, which is already expansion. So it is a huge opportunities, which is enhancing again security, competition to the consumer. So we are giving opportunity to everybody to the access of gas, which is cheaper. So I think that it matters. That's you made about synergy.
Yes, but, about the market test, the second
market
part
test,
of 2023.
Okay. So we would like to make also our market test, because first we would like to, let's say, cross-check, although we know that there are already shippers which has booked in Alexandroupolis, but we would like to validate this also in IGP infrastructure, and we are preparing even to launch this year the market test non-binding phase, which is a kind of also validation for the expansion itself. But we are quite sure that the results are going to be satisfied ensuring this expansion. With TEP, it is even a bit with small, with generally with small investment we can reach to 5 BCM, but the real expansion could happen whenever a compressor station in this phase happening. And generally, what I would say is that this, if we could say like a learning, what has happened is that everybody started to think and to catch up with all the infrastructure that hasn't been built before. Yeah. Right now it's boosting, and we started to be to mostly change. What has been changed after the loan is that from a kind of crisis management or ad hoc deals, we started to think strategically and to boost it, to make it quicker, like LNG terminal in Germany, like lots of energy projects which has been playing in Greece. So there is a kind of trend which is really promising, of course, now with the quickest speed, but in a strategic way.
Yes, thank you very much, Ms. Georgieva. I will turn to Ms. Piridaki, because we are talking about energy. Of course, we need combined transport for everything. So what is Aegean's stance on that? And could Thessaloniki be a kind of transit hub?
Definitely has the potential to become a transit hub. And we, of course, want to see this taking place. This, of course, needs also a serious investment in infrastructure in order to that to materialize. From our side, as I already said, we continue to invest in a network, which is actually what an airline can offer to a destination. So this summer, we actually doubled compared to previous summer the destinations. So we will fly to 24 straight direct connections, 24 international, plus 17 domestic connections. This we will offer the opportunity also for other transportation means to adjust to that, which means also for the cruise boats, which we happily see that there is some activity lately taking place from Thessaloniki. Also train, and of course the traffic through the automotive, which of course the highway is also supportive. So we strongly believe that it has the potential of becoming a hub, also a logistics hub, and next to that, it can facilitate other business activities that take place around logistics, also, and develop as an innovations hub as well. So if we want to envisage a change happening, we need to open up and see not only in terms of infrastructures and transport media, but also in terms of, as already referred to, in education, in innovation hubs, in business parks, in other facilities that will provide a 360 approach in terms of destination.
Thank you very much, Ms. Piridaki. Mrs. Zaharaki, we were talking about education and innovation and taking advantage of the fact that you have served also in the Ministry of Education. Can we touch upon the Thessaloniki's perspective as a city of attracting more students? And of course, this is another type of, not tourism, but you know, having people, more people in the city.
So first, I think we've heard, and I'm not sure we have the right sound. Can we be heard? Because I think the sound levels were a bit low before. Anyway, sorry for that. We touched upon so many important pillars of bilateral and multilateral relation, and I think that I should definitely focus the very first part of my reply also on some other pillars where we can see those synergies between the southeastern countries, where we've seen it happening, small success stories that I think that they can act as best practice for other countries. We saw that with the cruise business, and we will continue to see that in the years to come. We also see it with the business tourism approach, which of course, not only Thessaloniki, but you know, talking about Alexandroupoli, we can see that more and more conferences, more meetings, more B2Bs are happening, G2Gs or B2Gs happening, and this is something for the whole region to take stock of, the whole business tourism approach. We see it also with the paths, creating this European network of paths where people can go walking, they go cycling, and they reach, you know, the whole area, the South European Eastern part. And of course, we can also see with other routes that also have to do with agro-tourism, the wine routes, all the things that combine the primary sector with secondary and the services. And I think that these are amazing areas where we can all work together. We already do that when we're talking about the relationship with the competent ministries. Now, you talked about education, and I'm really passionate about that. I promise I will not take up any more of this very valuable time. But yes, in the past we have seen that Thessaloniki, being a university center, being an education center with an amazing array of public and private schools, we see people coming here to get the education they deserve. And we also see that with other private schools that have to do with sectors like tourism. We have amazing private and public tourism schools here in Thessaloniki. We see students coming from neighboring countries. We see students coming from southeastern countries. We will continue to work on that. Let me also tell you that we have lots of synergies with schools from neighboring countries where we take part in common contests and competitions. Mm-hmm. We have won chef and pastry chef contests. We just recently won one in cooperation with schools in Bulgaria, by the way. But the human capital aspect is what makes all the difference, is what exactly we've heard right now by Mrs. Pindakis. She talked about the innovation parties, and you know, those young scientists, they come here, they come to this innovation hub, they find the position that they were dreaming of. They will continue to be here and contribute to the academic / social / economic world of the city. And being the Deputy Minister of Education, like up until 2021, we worked very closely with our competent ministers in the European Council, but not only that, in the southeastern region, in order to promote, you know, more quality chances for our students, a wider variety of curriculum, and a greater connection between apprenticeship, between specialization and the market needs. So yes, of course, education is a key to what we've talked today. Mm-hmm. And we see it expanding also in the whole, you know, curriculum building and the relationship with the market needs.
Thank you very much, Mrs. Minister. We take very much pride in our Aristotle University of Thessaloniki of here, course. Which is Professor Panagiotou should be somewhere around here. He is running a program in cooperation with the Kosovo authorities. So it's a small but very important example of how we can proceed with networking the region in terms of education. Thank you very much. So I'll give the floor now to Mrs. Duran. Mrs. Duran, you have talked about the solidarity that was expressed during the earthquake. Do you think that this solidarity and what Mrs. Zaharaki has expressed before, saying that you know, there was a strenuous stage of our affairs, of our bilateral relations, can this continue in the future? I mean, this good climate that was established through this diplomacy of the earthquake, as we call it in diplomacy, let's say.
Yeah. Indeed, we saw it during the earthquake and after, just after it, because, like, as you told before, the cooperation and coordination plays a key role in overcoming the difficulties coming from diplomacy and some other businesses. But after the earthquake, like, we saw the solidarity, and like, even we have some disagreements and with some countries, even if there are some intractable issues or disputes, we can find a common ground and we can get close to each other, and we can also build something stronger within this difficulty. And I think and I hope that it will also continue in the future as well.
Thank you very much. We do hope so too. Κύριε Δήμαρχε, αφήνω το. Είμαστε ένα πάνελ γυναικών, όπως η κυρία Ζαχαράκη και ο κύριος Πρέσβης,
Mr. Mayor, παρατήρησε στην αρχή. We are a female panel. Αλλά θα αφήσω το τελευταίο λόγο σε εσάς ως οικοδεσπότη της στην πόλη μας. We left you for last because you are the host in our city. Are you optimistic about the future of the city and the region?
Okay, that's good.
Δεν ακούμε τον κύριο Δήμαρχο, δυστυχώς. Αν μπορούμε να του μεταφέρουμε ότι δεν έχουμε ήχο στην καμπίνα διερμηνέων. Η καμπίνα διερμηνέων δεν έχει ήχο, δυστυχώς δεν μπορούμε να μεταφράσουμε. Η καμπίνα διερμηνέων δεν έχει ήχο. Θα μπορούσατε να το μεταφέρετε, σας παρακαλώ.
So many times the large city, the foyer of the city hall, which applies for the people who suffered the problems of earthquake. So I can end up with some really optimism. I'm not the person who likes to be optimist without a reason. I'm sure that we prepared so many common projects. Nothing is heard.
Some of it was fake. Oops. Very good.
So you can hear me now, Mr.
So I'm really optimistic about the πραγματικά future. Πολύ αισιόδοξο για το μέλλον. Θεωρώ, όπω ανέφερα και προηγουμένω, ότι παρόλο που η περιοχή μα έχει πάσχει πολλά δεινά εξαιτία των δυσκολιών στι οικονομίε μα, των πόλεμων σειράξεων και όλη τη ιστορία μα, μπορούμε αυτή τη στιγμή να ελπίζουμε σε ένα πιο αισιόδοξο μέλλον, ένα μέλλον που θα έχουμε εξέλιξη στην αγορά της ενέργειας, αλλά ταυτόχρονα και τη συνεργασία μας σε πολιτισμικό επίπεδο. Αυτή τη στιγμή έχουμε τον κοινό στόχο να καταστήσουμε την περιοχή μας μια περιοχή ανάπτυξης, μια περιοχή αλληλεγγύης, μια περιοχή στην οποία θα μπορούμε μαζί, χέρι-χέρι, να αντιμετωπίζουμε μεγάλες φυσικές καταστροφές και ατυχήματα. Όμως, βέβαια, υπάρχουν και άλλες δυσκολίες, όπως για παράδειγμα η αντιμετώπιση της κλιματικής αλλαγής. Θα πρέπει να αντιμετωπίσουμε τις προκλήσεις αυτές. Εδώ είμαστε όμως, εδώ είμαστε για να χρησιμοποιήσουμε όσα μέσα έχουμε στη διάθεσή μας και να μεταμορφώσουμε την περιοχή μας, να αξιοποιήσουμε τον πολιτισμό μας και θεωρώ ότι υπάρχει μια κοινή κατανόηση ως προς το ότι η συνεργασία μας και η πόλη μας θα είναι μία από τις βαλκανικές χώρες που θα διαδραματίσει πρωτεύοντα ρόλο σε αυτό το δίκτυο βαλκανικής συνεργασίας. Πραγματικά είμαι πολύ αισιόδοξος για το μέλλον. Σας ευχαριστούμε πολύ, λοιπόν. Ας κλείσουμε με αυτό το αισιόδοξο μήνυμα του Δημάρχου. Σας ευχαριστώ όλες και όλους για την παρουσία σας και τη συμμετοχή σας. Να χειροκροτήσουμε το πάνελ μας.